you want to make an omelet, you've got to break a few eggs. And by omelet, I mean a theory of everything. And by a few eggs, I mean a billion billion subatomic particles obliterated in the next generation of giant particle colliders. In June, the European Strategy Group, the consortium of Europe's top particle physicists, published their vision for the next several years of particle physics experiments in the EU. A big part of that is the future circular collider, which, if it happens, will accelerate particles in a 100-kilometer circumference underground ring encircling Geneva. It'll be nearly four times the size of the Large Hadron Collider, and it will be capable of colliding particle beams with eight times the current LHC energy. The hope is that this will open the window to brand new physics and perhaps break the current deadlock in our quest for a theory of everything. But do the FCC or other upcoming collider experiments really have a chance of succeeding? Today we're going to discuss the incredibly ambitious plans for future colliders and try to honestly evaluate their prospects. But first, to get some perspective, we need to take a step back and talk about how collider technology got to where it is today. Physicists have been building machines to accelerate and subsequently obliterate particles since the 1920s. The first was the linear accelerator, or LINAC, which uses oscillating electric fields to accelerate charged particles in a straight line, while the beam is focused by magnetic fields. The cyclotron quickly followed. Here, particles are still accelerated by electric fields, but now a constant magnetic field causes the beam to spiral outwards from its central source. Once accelerated, the particles were typically slammed into a motionless target, often just a slab of metal. Some particles would collide with enough energy to be destroyed, and their energy would be released in the form of new particles. In those first collision experiments, all sort of never-before-seen particles were observed, allowing physicists to begin to map out the subatomic realm. There's a serious limit to the energy you can muster by colliding particles into a stationary object. To be precise, collision energy with a fixed target goes up with the square root of accelerator energy, which means you're wasting a lot of energy. On the other hand, if you can collide two beams moving in opposite directions with each other, then you get the full oomph of the impact, twice the energy of the individual beams. The key to doing this is to store the particle beams in a ring so that they can be collided at your leisure. To that end, the particle storage ring was invented by Gerard K. O'Neill in the mid-1950s. Within a few years, an Italian group built the first particle beam collider, the ADA, or Anello di Accumulazione. Apologies for the pronunciation. Its 4-meter ring collided electrons and positrons. The Soviets quickly followed with their VEP-1, which was smaller but collided electrons with one another to get 1,000 times higher luminosity than the ADA. In collider speak, luminosity is a measure of the number of particle collisions across an area over a time period. More collisions means more chance of producing weird particles. The Americans soon followed up with a 12-meter electron-electron collider with a similar luminosity to VEP-1, but with higher energies than even the ADA. Finally, we'd reached collision energies needed to test predictions of the still relatively new quantum electrodynamics. This was huge in solidifying our understanding of the quantum world. Graduating from electrons and positrons, in 1971, physicists started smashing protons together at CERN's Intersecting Storage Rings facility. CERN does have a habit of extremely literal naming. Since then, colliders have only grown in size and energy. The Tevetron at Fermilab in Illinois was for a while the largest collider in the world at 6.3 kilometers around, operating from 1983 to 2011. It generated collisions energetic enough to produce the very massive top quark, and so enabled the discovery of the final fermion, or matter particle, in the Standard Model. This entire effort reached its pinnacle with the Large Hadron Collider at CERN in Switzerland. It propels twin proton beams in opposite directions around a 27-kilometer circumference ring beneath the Swiss and French countrysides. The beams cross in four locations where they collide with energies of several tera electron volts, which is, for reference, a lot of energy. And the crowning achievement of the LHC was the discovery of the Higgs boson in 2012. The existence of the Higgs confirms our explanation of how the elementary particles acquire mass, which, of course, we've covered previously. In a sense, this was the last missing piece of the Standard Model. the one remaining particle that physicists thought must exist, LHC particle hunters expected that to just be the beginning, that their giant collider would go on to discover many new particles to take us beyond the Standard Model. The most highly anticipated were the particles predicted by supersymmetry, or SUSY. This is an extension to the Standard Model designed to solve several of its outstanding problems, most notably the hierarchy problem, the fact that there's a huge difference between the strength of gravity and the other forces, and a huge difference between the measured masses of known particles and what we expect their masses to be from quantum field theory calculations. The Higgs particle in particular should have an enormous mass if our Standard Model understanding is the whole picture. The fact that the Higgs turned out at a mere 100 times the mass of the proton seems to indicate that something beyond the Standard Model was needed. SUSY solves the hierarchy problem by proposing symmetric counterparts to the known particles. Among other things, those counterparts should help cancel out the interactions of the known particles with the elementary quantum fields on which those particles live, eliminating most of their mass in the process. But the supersymmetric counterparts do their jobs most neatly if they have masses slash energies in a particular range between 100 and 1000 giga electron volts. The Large Hadron Collider reaches energies a few times higher than the top of that range, so it should have seen such particles by now. But after a decade of searches with the LHC, there's still no sign of SUSY. So we find ourselves at an impasse. The Standard Model is complete, but there is no compelling hint of the next direction to take. So what next? Well, it's clear that the Standard Model is not the whole picture. Besides the hierarchy problem, the Standard Model also doesn't explain why neutrinos have mass, doesn't seem to give us a particle that could explain dark matter, and there are other anomalies like the muon's magnetic moment. In general, to get closer to a theory that unifies our understanding of the Standard Model's motley zoo of particles and forces, we probably need to achieve higher energies, energies even closer to the instant of the Big Bang, when the forces of nature were literally unified, as we've talked about before. There are other clever ways to probe these energies, for example using natural particle accelerators like the Sun or supernovae or quasars or galactic magnetic fields, which continually spray the Earth with particles at higher energies than we can hope to replicate. But these ultra-high energy cosmic rays are rare, and to reliably detect a new particle, we need to watch the result of billions of collisions. We need very high luminosities. Bigger and better colliders may be our best shot. Let's start with better before we move to bigger. The LHC is currently in a long upgrade process, with the final result being a factor of a couple increase in power, but more importantly, a factor of 5 increase in luminosity. This will be achieved by upgrading the existing components with more cutting-edge versions. For example, better superconducting magnets for more precise control of more energetic beams. We've been in the first offline phase since 2018, with operations set to resume in 2021, and there'll be another 2-year shutdown before the new high luminosity LHC comes online in 2027. The point of this upgrade isn't primarily to access higher energies where new particles might exist, but rather to make the LHC much better at studying the current range. If SUSY particles or other high mass particles do exist, then they may be actually a good way beyond the energy range of the LHC, and so for that, we do need a bigger collider. And so we come to the future circular collider. If it goes ahead, it'll hit energies of 100 tera electron volts, 100 times the current LHC energy. Eventually, the FCC will be smashing protons like the LHC does, but to start with, it'll collide electrons and positrons with the express intention of making as many Higgs particles as possible. Okay, firstly, why electrons and positrons? Well, remember that the first particle colliders worked with electron-positron beams, and for good reason. They are easier to work with compared to protons. It's easier to achieve the energies and luminosities to produce, for example, large numbers of Higgs particles in relatively clean collisions. But why build a Higgs factory at all? Haven't we already discovered the Higgs? Well, discovered, yes, but there's still a lot we don't know. For example, at our current energies, we don't know how often it interacts with the super heavy top quark, a process that might contain hints about new physics. The Higgs can also be used as a direct search for new particles. The FCC will eventually graduate to proton-proton collisions, which will open up the discovery space further. The future circular collider will cost tens of billions over its life. So is this a good investment? Well, it'll certainly tell us more about the Higgs, and it may discover that elusive clue to take us beyond the Stanton model. However, there's no guarantee that any new particles exist in the expanded energy range that the FCC will probe. That said, you can't know if you don't look. The future circular collider is the priority defined by the European Strategy Group. But what about the US? Ever since Europe won the giant collider game with the LHC, particle physicists in the US have focused on smaller experiments. Fermilab's Tevetron was for a while the largest collider in the world, but it was shut down in 2011 because it just couldn't compete with the LHC. Since then, the Illinois facility has reinvented itself as leaders in, among other things, neutrino experiments. When we visited Fermilab earlier this year, we saw the linear particle accelerator that's under development to become DUNE's neutrino source. But the next big-ish US collider will most likely be the Electron Ion Collider. It won't be anywhere near the size of even the LHC, but it will have a more focused mission. It'll smack electrons into protons and other nucleons to probe the detailed structure and interactions between quarks. The EIC is the priority program endorsed by the National Academy of Sciences. And while it doesn't quite have final approval yet, if it does happen, it'll be at Brookhaven National Labs on Long Island, starting in around 10 years. It'll be an order of magnitude cheaper than the future circular collider at an estimated 1.6 to 2.6 billion. But I guess that's still a chunk of change. So, is it worth it to do this sort of fundamental science, even though the immediate return to the nation and world are vague? Well, putting aside the fact that our modern world is built on the technologies that came from this sort of fundamental physics research, I want to leave you with a quote by Fermilab's first director, Robert Wilson, when questioned by the Senate regarding the value of the Tevetron to the US and in particular, whether it helped compete against the Russians. He said, "Only from a long-range point of view of a developing technology, otherwise it has to do with, are we good painters, good sculptors, great poets? I mean all the things that we really venerate and honor in our country and are patriotic about. In that sense, this new knowledge has all to do with honor and country, but it has nothing to do directly with defending our country, except to make it worth defending." Dr. Wilson was addressing the US Senate, and so he spoke of the nation. But the larger value of this sort of work is to elevate humanity. Whether it happens now or later, I, for one, am patriotic about being part of a species capable of doing something like this, of coordinating thousands of scientists over many decades to build these crazy machines that can crack open the inner workings of space-time. Hey, so as you know, filming a YouTube show in space takes a lot of resources, and I just want to thank all of our Patreon supporters for making it so much more doable. Without you, we'd probably have to film in like low Earth orbit rather than in deep space. Gross. But today, a special thank you to Alec SL, who's supporting us at the Quasar level. Alec, for complete transparency, we're using your contribution to purchase something like 10 to the power of 30 protons to inject into the future circular collider, assuming it actually gets built. We're currently piling them up as tanks of hydrogen in Switzerland with post-it notes with your name on them. If any of those particular protons happen to produce a previously undiscovered particle in the collider, we'll be naming it the Alec SL Eno. Hey, it's a bit of a long shot, but you deserve the chance at glory. Thank you for your help. Last time, we talked about the most destructive, parasitic, and generally unhealthy relationships between the stars, from novae to black widow binaries. Let's get to your questions. Jason Carter asks a tricky one. When two black holes merge and share a single warped event horizon, shouldn't there be a thin sliver of space in between them that is not flowing towards either singularity? Well, actually not so much. The key point is that space doesn't have to flow directly towards the singularity. Think of the case of the rotating black hole. The singularity is a ring, and relatively few geodesics or free-falling paths hit the singularity. Most pass through the ring. In the case of merging black holes, you can think of space as more flowing towards the center of mass, although it's not quite that simple. Numerical general relativity calculations reveal an event horizon cross-section that's called a pair of pants function. It looks like cross-sections of a pair of pants moving upwards. They start separate, and the event horizons move towards each other as they join, and at some point the event horizons touch and then merge. At the instant after that touch, what's happening at the seam? Well, the flow of space anywhere on the event horizon has to be exactly perpendicular to the face of the event horizon. So at the seam, the flow of space is straight down. In principle, there should be a point right at the center where there is no flow. If you were a point-like particle, you could just hang there. But everywhere else, including above and below that point, the space is still flowing inwards. David Koser asks how we would describe the interaction of two merging stars whose combined mass exceeds the Chandrasekhar limit. For those who don't know, the Chandrasekhar limit is 1.4 times the mass of the Sun. It's the maximum mass of a white dwarf star before crushing gravitational pressure causes electrons to be pounded into protons to form neutrons, causing the whole thing to collapse into a neutron star. That happens in the cores of massive stars when they die, but what about white dwarfs that gain more mass after they form, or that collide to have above that mass? Well, the limit still applies, but typically you don't get a neutron star. In order to get a neutron star, you need a very symmetrical, clean application of pressure. If the white dwarf exceeds the limit by cannibalizing a companion star, and also presumably if it collides with another star, then the process is very asymmetric and messy. Instead, you're most likely to just get an explosion as thermonuclear fusion rips through the white dwarf's carbon and oxygen interior. That gives you a supernova and leaves nothing behind but a pretty cloud of gas. Leandro asks how we managed to get such good sound quality out here in space. Well, space isn't really empty. There's an average density of one atom per cubic meter, so technically sound is possible. Really, it's about engaging your diaphragm and projecting. Vocative Case says they will miss Bahaar's painting. Yeah, I miss it already. But with the power of modern green screen technology, I mean replicator technology out here in space, why should we deprive ourselves? Nice.